It's been a weekend of upsets, controversy and thrillers. A draw, a kick after the siren to win, a comeback story and finally the Cats get beaten. With seven flags between them, Cameron Ling, Simon Black and Nick Maxwell make up the panel. Irish star Pierce Hanley and Premiership pie Brent McCaffer, fresh off their big wins yesterday, are the guests. Let's get it started.
And away we go to get things started. More of the crowd and we're into it. This will be a lifter. It goes bang. Looks through it and gets it. Valentine's got it. Whoa, that's awesome. That is brilliant. How about this? Kicks the goal. He's been terrific. Not from there. Superstar. And he's put it through. High fives all around.
Oh. Right through the middle. What a fairy tale for Staker.
Here's Cracker. He's got it. Collingwood are back in front.
It might have had the distance. Oh. Reed! Oh, that could get them points.
Power lead. Outstanding from Jeff.
Sinclair tried to turn his man. Oh. The summer off the ground for Bradley.
And he's just so excited.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Game. Great crowd in. It's been wonderful football all weekend. Started on Friday night and yesterday it was just sensational football. Three games still to come. So much to talk about. Great panel to do exactly that. The 2010 Magpies Premiership captain Nick Maxwell. Welcome to you, Maxie. Great win last night.
It was. Outstanding win. And just for people at home, no, I haven't had a collagen injection. I'm sorry about not being clean shaved. I actually had my teeth put through my bottom lip last week, so I've got about 15 stitches in there. So it's not looking real good, but it's not something I need with a head like this, but that's footy.
A lot of ladies pay a lot of money to look like you do right now with that bottom lip. But three flags, a Brownlow, a Norm Smith, a rare CV, a world-class bloke. Simon Black, welcome to the panel. Sensational yesterday, 18 lead changes, 10-point winners.
Yeah, it was an amazing game. We got to wear the heritage jumper yesterday and had a lot of Fitzroy supporters come out and support us for the day, which is great. And what a great fairy tale story for Brent Staker coming back from 2 years with knee reconstruction.
Yeah, we'll speak about the Lions and the Bombers in detail. Three flags for the Cats and now semi-professional surfer. Cameron Ling, welcome to you.
I like the sound of that, home. Yeah, the professional surfer. Great to be here and I'm just really excited. One of my favourite players of all time. Simon Black, getting to work with him. But on the other hand, me and Maxie, we've got a bit of tension at the moment. We're not wrapped about last night. Well, I'm not. He's over the moon.
I thought you were talking about me.
It was supposed to be Black, Maxwell, Ling, but we've changed it around just so things remain sort of like Switzerland. The results so far this weekend, Friday night, if you missed it, well, look forward to Nick Nat. It was an enormous mark and then the pressure kicked after the siren to see the Eagles home. The Bombers, short price favourites. The Lions, 10-point winners. Simon Black, prolific before being subbed out with just general old age and tiredness. Hawks, unbelievably good. Ruffy was 5, 83-point winners. And then Saturday night football, it was an absolute feast. The Suns in the twilight game got home, 2 in a row. They are just knocking on the door of the 8. But the Pies, out to a big lead. The Cats came back, led by 13 points at the final change. Pies get home by a goal. And the Swans led by 27 points, 10 minutes to play, draw. First at the SCG, I'll make it second at the SCG, first for the Dockers in their history. Cats dislodged at the top, Hawks now by percentage on top. Essendon and the Swans, they just sit third and fourth. Swans and Freo after the draw, 4 and 5 together. Knocking on the door in ninth, Richmond. If they win today, they jump in. Gold Coast, 4 and 4. Extraordinary. And the Giants, the only side yet to register a win. As we look at the Steel Blue Coleman Medal ladder, Josh Kennedy, 2 on Friday night. Lindsay Thomas couldn't register. Jack Revolt plays the Demons this afternoon and might just shoot to the top of the Coleman. Cloak 1, Cameron, he's a genuine star, 4 goals. Let's start at the MCG, Saturday night football, Maxie. What was made during the week, Nathan Buckley and the Pies under pressure given the Saturday night loss? Week's a long time in football.
Yeah, it was a big win for us and for a couple of reasons. Obviously, the spotlight was on us during the week and people really put us under the pump. People have spoken about our injuries and guys who aren't playing, but we really tried to focus on the guys who were playing and I thought that our young guys really stood up for us and obviously against a quality outfit like Geelong, who were undefeated, we always knew it was going to be a tough game and just wrapped for the boys that they got the job done.
You could see at the final siren there how much that win meant to the Collingwood boys. It was pretty similar to the Brisbane boys against Essendon yesterday as well. When that siren went, there was a lot of emotion as well.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, we'd come down and been belted the last couple of times in Melbourne, so for us it meant a hell of a lot. Brent Staker, as we see there, 2 years out with a knee reconstruction, fairy tale, kicked the winning goal for us, and just a great day to be wearing the Heritage jumper.
So they were the finishers here in Melbourne. At the SCG, it was remarkable. The final 20 seconds in particular, we mentioned that the Swans led by 27 points, 10 minutes to play. Let's have a look at the last 20 seconds at the SCG. Michael Johnson from 51 metres. All he needs to do is register a point. Enter Mr. Reid. Leo Barriers, that saved 2 points.
Incredible mark by Sam Reid, but I can't believe he didn't make the distance, Johnson. He was only 50 out. He could kick that every day of the week and just needed a score and didn't get him over the line. Unbelievable.
It was a win for Brett Kirk. Used to play for the Swans, now coaches the Dockers. He would have left pretty happy knowing the Buddhist that he is. We go to Nick Nat on Friday night and, well, just remarkable again. It was the Kangaroos game for much of the night. They led for 73%. So Nick Nat takes the big fly, needs to settle, compose himself and, importantly, kick the goal. And he did.
He said afterwards he was pretty nervous about the whole thing, but you wouldn't have noticed when you watched him. He was just unbelievable. Took that mark, went back, and it was just like he was never going to miss.
And, Haim, 35th time in history with a kick after the siren to win the game. There's been... It must be... It's almost the childhood dream to be able to take a big mark like that, go back, siren goes, and kick the winning goal for your team. It must be an incredible feeling. You boys knew we didn't get to do it. No one
kidding?
On here.
Me?
Talking about the nervousness of Nick Nat, he tweeted yesterday and said... bluntly, my butt cheeks were very tight. So, nice sense of humour from Nick Nat. But he's been just such an important inclusion for the Eagles, hasn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll look at that game in a little bit more detail later on. But he's the difference. He really makes them a dangerous team. And he's an incredible footballer. He's just so athletic. And a lot was made about Magic Door and Nick Nat coming up against each other, both two incredible athletes. But, yeah, it's great the way the game's going, just these phenomenal athletes, and I'm pretty happy I'm retired, to be honest, when you've got blokes like that running around. It just keeps taking the game to a new level.
You talked about the goals after the siren. Obviously, Tommy Hawkins last year against the Hawks was a part of it. We've just put a few together. You remember it was the Longmuir pocket as well that Nick Nat kicked the goal in, but these are some through the ages. Benny Dixon against the Blues, and this is the Longmuir pocket just sort of sliding on through. I think we've got one. This is Carmichael Hunt to sink the Richmond Tigers last year. And then the T-bone. Big, big thing to seize the moment. One is to do it in training, one is to do it when it doesn't matter, to do it after the siren. Amazing.
And it wasn't after siren, but Blackie, what was the emotion like when Staker kicked that goal? Obviously, being out for a couple of years with those knee injuries, what was the emotion like then? Because I'm tipping it was pretty similar.
Oh, it was incredible, Maxie. We obviously played Essendon, a really good side. And look, it was an arm wrestle all day, and you all got the feel that whoever got just beyond a goal lead late would probably get over the line. And it took to the 28th minute mark of that fourth quarter for that to happen. So, I was on the bench watching, but everyone ran over all over Stakes, and couldn't be more happier for him. He's a wonderful guy too.
Well said, Lucky. Yesterday, Pierce Hanley was very good. He's our first guest. Brent McCaffrey, he'll be joining us as well. A few things you don't know about Simon Black later in the show. But Pierce Hanley, the Irishman, he was great yesterday. He's in.
The weather was a big factor. I hated using sunscreen. Didn't even use it back home, and I was burned every second there, every time I went out, pretty much.
Hey, Waddy, no surgery this month for you. Hey, hook foot. Hey, Waddy.
We get started on a Saturday afternoon. Watson has it charged down. The long kick. Sorko. There's the first for the Lions. Sorko's kicked one. He's kicked two. Can keep going here, Myers. Thumping kick. Gives it everything and kicks a goal. Lewenberger just stood underneath it. Did the roving and the goaling. Comes out Heppel's way. And Heppel, how about that? Maloney outstanding, here he is again from Lewenberger. Oh, this would be something. Wonderful team goal. They turn it over. Oh, it was brilliant again from Cramery. Strong Brown. That is extraordinary. Jonathan Brown, the skipper, he slots the goal. The Lions won't go away. And it was Staker, was it, the charge. He got tipped by Heppel. A brave effort for Staker to get back to football at this level. He's put it right through the middle. What a fair tale for Staker.
Great afternoon's football at Etihad Stadium. Welcome back to Game Day, and welcome to Game Day for the first time to Pierce Hanley.
Thanks for having me.
Well, nice to have you on. Always nice to have fresh faces. And you don't do a lot of media here in Melbourne, but we loved watching you play yesterday. Before we got onto the game, just tell us a little about the Pierce Hanley story. You've never, or hadn't, touched a football until 2007.
No, I hadn't. I was out here in 2005 and played the international rules. And from there, I think Graham Allen spotted me and brought me over in 2007. And yeah, until then, I hadn't touched a football.
And just, there was an article in the Herald Sun yesterday talking about your life. You've got two brothers, two sisters, and then your parents, Andy and Natalie, decided to turn your house into a foster home. You gained four more brothers and sisters.
Yeah, it's a busy Christmas.
I hope they all give the presents out generously. Do they come out and have they seen you play?
They haven't seen me play an AFL game. They've seen reserve games, so they haven't been out for a few years. But my father is, I think he's on the way today or tomorrow. He's coming out for the next two games.
And Irish role models, Lingy, have been plenty.
Well, absolutely, there's been plenty. Did you, when you were in Ireland and growing up, did you keep an eye on the players who almost trailblazed the AFL route for you? Sean White, Jimmy Steins, Ty Kinnelly as well?
Yeah, I used to stay up late on a Friday and watch the AFL, the highlights package, and yeah, I used to follow Ty pretty closely.
Was he a similar type of player too, the way you play? Did you kind of base your game on him?
Yeah, well, I watch Vision of Tiger all the time. I got just a DVD made up of every game he played, and I used to study that and try and emulate it in the reserves, and yeah.
Becoming your own man, going beautifully. Let's have a look at Essendon versus Brisbane yesterday afternoon. The Bombers, well, they're expected to win. They had a huge week with Asada. A couple of players look reasonably tired and jaded, but take nothing away from the Lions. They led at quarter time. And then after quarter time, Blackie, 18 lead changes. 14 points was the biggest margin of the match. And in the end, it was Brent Staker who sealed it to give the Lions a 10-point win. A wonderful win.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely, Haim. Look, yeah, guys, it was a fantastic game to be part of from a Lions perspective yesterday. Dane Zorko was absolutely brilliant, very close to probably being best on ground. And look, yeah, a real arm wrestle, as you said, 18 lead changes in the second half. The pressure was what we had to bring yesterday, and I thought we did that really well. We just needed to try to hang in the contest for as long as possible. When you're playing a good side like Essendon are, you just got to try and hang in there as long as you can, and that's what we tried to do. We're pretty proud to wear the Heritage jumper. The Bombers are a great side. Heath Hocking could play soccer. And Matty Lauenberger is in some really good form, a beautiful tap down there to Brett Maloney. One of the best home and away victories I've had for quite some time. Probably haven't had too many of those, but a great day to be a part of, and obviously very special for Brent Staker, as we've mentioned. Best part of 2 years out with two knee reconstructions, and got a chance late in the game to win it for us, and he did. The three things I learned from yesterday. Look, we need to bring that pressure every week. If we're going to beat any side, we need to bring enormous pressure. We did that really well. Second thing, Jake Carlisle's become an elite defender. He's very impressive. We've had a few scalps this year, and he's developing all the time. And my little mate, Dane Zorko, reconfirmed to me what a great little player he is and brings enormous energy to our group. And he's a beauty.
And Blackie, you see Zorko up forward most of the time. Is he someone who can push in the midfield a lot more as he gets that fitness base? We know he's been at state league level for a while.
Yeah, absolutely, Maxie. He's got that ability to... He's a pretty good endurance runner, actually, and he's good in close, good hands and quite clean, quite composed. So I think he'll be in the middle a little bit more up in the future.
Pierce, Blackie mentioned Brent Staker and what a fairy tale it was for him to kick the winning goal. Tell us a little bit about his comeback, two knee reconstructions. He must have trained so hard to be able to get back and play AFL, and wonderful that he could kick that goal.
Yeah, he's worked very hard. He's been out of the game a long time, and even after coming back after his knee reco, he had an upset in the pre-season, which kept him out for a further 6 weeks. But yeah, it's great to see him come back yesterday and even kick the winning goal. It was amazing.
Now, there's a few Brisbane Lions fans in the crowd today. Everyone wants to know, Pierce Hanley's out of contract at the end of the year. Are you happy here in Australia? You're happy to stay at the Brisbane Lions? Will you be signing for a long time?
Yeah, I love Australia and loving Brisbane at the moment.
Blackie's pretty happy with that too, I think.
Blackie, you talked through Pierce's highlights yesterday afternoon. We continued to talk about his speed and his agility. Able to be running left, flat out, be right, flat out, and then pull up to a stop. It's a really good game.
It is. He's been spoken about his kick, and it's one of the best kicks in our group. He's taken to our ball magnificently well. Put a lot of time in, mind you. He's trained very hard. He's slept with a ball over here. He's taken balls to restaurants with him to learn the feel of the Sharon, and it's a real credit to him the way he's picked it up.
Is it true that you actually slept with the ball for the first few years?
Not for a year. The first 6 months I carried it everywhere and sometimes it came to bed with me.
It's like a kid when you're dubbing the football, you can smell it.
Yeah, I remember doing that when I was about 6 years of age. Yeah. You just sleep with your footy, absolutely. But Blackie, I want to know what. You had leather poisoning in the first half on the weekend and got subbed out. What was that? Is it an injury? Is it just management? Or obviously you just thought you were getting too much of it?
No, it was my second game back yesterday. I was only the sub last week, so I'm just trying to get a bit of match fitness. And Vossi said to me at halftime, you'll probably come off and be our sub. And it was quite early in the third quarter as it turned out I came off. But look, it was just great to be out there. I'm loving being back and playing with the guys. And hopefully the next few weeks can build my base and play a bit more.
How is the knee? All good?
Yeah, it's great. Yeah, it's really good. It's come through the last month really well. And it's handling the loads of games now really good.
And Pierce, just want to ask you about your coach. Obviously, been under the pump a little bit in the media. They tend to do that with coaches. just wanted to ask you, how was he emotionally before the game and trying to get you guys up?
Yeah, he was. He kept his cool. You could tell we wore a three-piece jumper. We wore a three-piece jumper, and it meant a lot to him. But it's great to get the win for Vossi. He's been under a fair bit of pressure.
You could even see with his emotions when they really hit the front, when Staker kicked that goal, and he knew that they were going to win the game, and he was still pretty stone-faced and didn't really want to give too much away. So it's clear that he sort of got that focus now. We want to make sure we keep doing what we're doing.
Yeah, he was definitely happy with the win, but we've a big job next week. Back up, we've struggled with that lately, so hopefully we can do that for him.
Haim, great day for Brisbane, but potentially a couple of things to come out of the game, which hopefully doesn't impact them too much. Potential match review panel. Daniel Merritt here on Michael Hurley. He was concussed, a sling tackle. I think he thought Michael Hurley had the ball and continued with the tackle. That one's probably going to be looked at because of the fact that Michael Hurley did suffer concussion and had to be subbed out of the game. The other one, Justin Clark on Elliot Kavanagh, the hip and shoulder. I don't know what you blokes think, but maybe a touch late, but arrived almost at the exact time that the ball arrived. Maxi,
It always, when you slow it down in slow motion, it always looks worse, but there was two options for him. Number one is to go completely past him and his coach is going to kick his backside for doing that and letting him go the other way. Or number two, stop and put your hands up and cop it yourself and you end up getting lined up yourself. So I don't think there was any malice in it and I think that he'll be okay.
But certainly both will be looked at and fingers crossed, Blackie and Pierce, that the guys get off.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there are a couple of really good emerging players for us. Well, Rogers obviously our fullback. We can't afford to lose him. So, fingers crossed, mate.
Pierce just whispered, "Don't be fine." Blakey head-to-head with Pierce Hanley after the break. Brent McCaffer still to come. And footy flashbacks and Sunday footy all on 7.
Bang! Long and strong and it's a goal!
Gaelic's amateur and you don't get paid for it, and it was a chance to play professionally. Some people that were happy for me, they knew it was a good opportunity. Then there was the other 50% that thought I wasn't being loyal to my old football and to Gaelic football, who had brought me up and made me the player I was.
This is a wonderful move from Hanley, the Irish.
Don't tell
me. Deserves a goal! Is a goal!
But the weather was a big factor. I hated using sunscreen. Didn't even use it back home, and I was burned every second day, every time I went out pretty much. Just love competing, love winning, and the fact that Brisbane have given me a chance to win with Brisbane and the time I've had here would be brilliant.
The great story of Pierce Hanley, it's been a wonderful journey. Pierce, you came to Australia for the first time in 2005, played in the under-17 team for Ireland against Australia in the international series and won the Ron Barassi medal.
Yeah, it was good. It was a good chance to get out of Ireland, and had a great trip with a few of the boys and ended up playing against a few of the lads of the Brisbane Lions, like Matty Loonberger, Tom Collier, James Hawksley, so a few old teammates, and I'll be proud. Apparently we had a biff, I don't remember it, but he said we did.
Did you ever win in the biff?
Yeah, I gave my blood nose apparently, I don't remember.
Lingi, Australia's game, a multicultural game, we've put a side together of those that have been born overseas. It's an extraordinary lineup now of talent, and it's not as if they're making up the list. These are seriously influential players.
Yeah, it's incredible. You think how hard it is for Blackie was a Perth boy moving all the way to Brisbane. That was a big move. But for guys who've been born overseas and lived overseas to move over to a completely new country and to come and have an impact like that team, there's some fantastic names there, and they just continue to take AFL footy to a new level. It really is incredible.
To the Gold Coast we go. The Western Bulldogs went travelling and got beaten. The Gold Coast Suns have won their second game in a row for the first time in the club's history. They're 4-4 for the season. Campbell Brown, second game back, he was terrific. Gary Ablett, as always, just racked them up. Adam Cooney, 31, but 32-point winners, the Suns.
Yeah, it was always going to be a good game of footy. Both teams down the bottom half of the ladder. Well, not the Suns anymore after another quality win. Jakey Stringer here strolling in. He kicked 3 goals for the night. But it was a battle of the young guns. The Bulldogs have really been developing their young list. We know how good the Gold Coast Suns young players are, and they're just getting better. Matty Shaw finishing a goal there with a handball from Jager O'Meara. They're now starting to realise that potential that we all thought they would. They're being able to finish off their work, stay in games for longer, and they're beating the teams that they really have to beat. They've beaten the GWS Giants, they've beaten Melbourne, they've also beaten St Kilda, and now they've knocked off the Bulldogs as well. Jared Harbrow really enjoyed this one, kicking a goal against his old team. The Bulldogs, there's a lot to like there. They've still got these experienced players like Bob Murphy who just add that bit of class and a bit of polish. But the young players are developing. They are certainly improving. But in the end, it was the Gold Coast Suns pretty comfortably. They won the game by 32 points and did a terrific job. The three things that I learnt from the game is that the Suns, they are gradually reaching their potential. They've still got a bit to go, but I like the look of some of their young players. They're getting better and better. The Bulldogs, they need to re-sign Adam Cooney. Their young players are really improving, but they need those experienced players leading the way, and Adam Cooney's probably the best of them all. And Campbell Brown, he still has a spot in the Suns team. He missed 6 games through suspension, but what he does is he provides that really hard, strong body for them, provides that bit of experience for the Gold Coast Suns young players, and he was able to kick a few goals as well. He was able to be dangerous, and he needs to support the likes of Gary Ablett. We know what Gary's going to give them every single week, but if Campbell Brown can step up as well as one of those experienced players, that really helps those young players with their development.
And Lingy, Zach Smith, we saw he was subbed out, he was injured. How bad is it? What is it? And actually, how did that role change? Who stood in and took over the job in the ruck?
Yeah, well, I haven't heard the news from the Suns yet about just how bad it is, but if we see here, it's his jumping knee that does it, and it looks so simple. It's scary when it looks that simple because sometimes they end up being the worst. He was subbed out of the game. He's such a quality young big fella. Hopefully he's all right, Maxi. They had to throw it around a bit because they're missing a couple of their big guys. Charlie Dixon didn't play. So they had to get a little bit creative with their big man department.
Talk about youngsters. Jager O'Meara impresses every week.
Just incredible. For a bloke who's just come straight in, he's 18 years of age, he's built so physically mature. He just looks comfortable. He looks like he's in his 7th or 8th year. He's strong at the contest. He attacks the ball the right way. And then the great thing is, and this is probably the most exciting thing about him, he gets the ball in space and is really damaging. He's not just a hard, strong body. He's a gun. And what exactly that was, it's Stevie Johnson-esque, that. And to think that he had the composure to do that in only his first season of footy. Just incredible and a remarkable talent.
That's the thing about him, is he? Most young players can get a little bit rattled, but he's so composed out there from, you know, his first half a dozen games. It's been incredible.
Yeah, and maybe it's his maturity in his head, but his body's mature as well. He's got a better body than I ever had for my whole career. And he's just built like a bloke who's had 7 or 8 pre-seasons and has played a lot of footy.
Tell me, Pierce, when you arrived, did you know much about Simon Black? We're about to show his CV. It's been an incredible journey. Has he been a good mentor?
Yeah, he's been a very good mentor. Didn't know a hell of a lot about him, to be honest. I did when I was watching. There's a bit going on there, isn't
there? That's solid, home. That's very solid.
There's a couple of things to note out of this. The Brownlow medal in 02, twice he's been runner-up in the Brownlow, which is insane stuff, and the best and fairest. He's won 3 in unbelievably good sides, 5 times a runner-up in the best and fairest.
Just remarkable. So consistent, and
he deserves his own throne.
I often get asked the question, and I don't want to embarrass Blackie here because he's such a humble guy. But ask the question: who was my favourite player to play on, and best player to play against? And it was Simon Black. He just, you'd be all over him. You'd think you'd have him covered, and he'd just get the footy, and he'd walk away going, "How the hell did you do that, Blackie? Stop getting the footy." You're just a remarkable player, and sorry for embarrassing you, mate, but a remarkable career, and deserves all the applause he can get.
Blackie, you're in charge of quick hands with Pierce at this point. Ready? You know how this works. Quick questions, quick answers.
Yep.
Okay, Piercy.
Been brief.
Some tough questions here, mate. First question. Is it true you didn't have an alarm clock in the early days and missed a few training sessions after nights out?
True.
I knew the answer to that one. Okay, is your home's doubled as a foster home. How many kids are in the house?
9, including me.
Okay. Did you get any favourable treatment by your parents?
Before we were foster kids, I was the middle child, so the neglected one.
How many kids to a bedroom?
The girls doubled up. There was, two in each.
Okay.
Three boys in one room, then two.
Okay. And now you live with Clay Beams. Has he tried to convert you to tattoos and his sleeves?
Yeah, he's tried. He's trying to get his girlfriend to get tattoos as well, but she's not. She's not folding.
Good beautiful. Work, mate. Stay strong. Stay strong.
Absolutely. Is it true you get invited to a weekly game of golf with some of your teammates because you are so easy to beat?
False.
What do you play off?
Oh, I don't want to say it. 24.
Well done, mate. Fantastic.
Now, you've also brought in this for the game day team. That'll be auctioned later. Tell us about that jumper.
Yeah, it's a three-peat jumper. I'm bringing Blackie's number. Not sure why I'm bringing that in, but it's for a few names are put on there. We wore it yesterday. We have a very good record when we wear these jerseys, and we're wearing it again in round 10 against the Pies.
Well, simple solution, wear it every week.
that's what we said yesterday, so we might be doing that.
Pierce, great to have you on the show. Well played yesterday. Pierce Stanley, great to have him on. Stevo, he's got all the latest news in football and all the emotion and reactions from an amazing game on Friday night. Brent McCaffrey as well, he's joining us this morning on game day.
To outlast North Melbourne at the very last gasp. And he's put it through. Eagles win. A remarkable game of football. High fives all around. And they come from everywhere. The West Coast Eagles teammates to celebrate with Nick Natanui.
Brisbane have won the premiership and have beaten the champs.
It's all over. The Brisbane Lions are premiers again. But the Lions have gone back to back to back, become the greatest side of the modern era.
The torture is finally over. Geelong are the premiers.
It's over.
The Cats. Vindication has arrived. Beyond a shadow of a doubt, the Cats prove themselves as one of the greatest teams of the modern era.
So Collingwood wins by their greatest ever margin in a grand final. It doesn't get better than that.
Crowned by serious football talent, 7 premierships between them.
Just leave that on loop. that'll do us for the day, I reckon.
There was silence watching that. I mean, when you see it, it must bring back wonderful memories. Is the reality of winning on the final day, Maxi, as powerful as you dreamed and imagined?
Absolutely, absolutely. But I think more than anything, you want to... It's just like when you explain to people about playing your first game. When you first get to a footy club, you're desperate to play your first game. And then as soon as you play one, you get a taste for it and you just go, oh, I just want to play another one. I just want to play another one. And then you start to get serious about the success of the club once you actually become a regular player and you go, geez, I'm jealous of that. I just want to win one premiership. But then when you get one, you start to get greedy and go, I want more. These two were proof of that.
Did you realise, Blackie, what sort of a side you're a part of then?
Probably halfway through the second year, I think we did. In 02, we were probably the top team in the competition. Probably took the mantle over from Essendon then. And we were able to obviously have a great win in 02 against Collingwood, close game in that final. But then the third year was the special one. We thought we could create some real special history, and that was probably what probably defined us as a group. Having Lee Matthews at the helm really enables us to stay in the moment and continue to strive for and continue to improve it all along the way.
Lingy, what about when you haven't won on the MCG after a loss on the grand final day?
Oh, it's a terrible day. It's kind of funny, 08 still annoys me big time. But you're sitting out there, you're watching all these ecstatic people, so happy going up and getting their medals, and you're just sitting there and you just feel gutted. You can't believe, you're looking up at the scoreboard thinking, That can't be right. Oh, I'm just absolutely shattered about that. So it's not good, but you kind of get that taste of that, and then you get to win another one, and it makes it all worthwhile. You can put that behind you a little bit, home.
You should be okay. You've got three premierships. Yeah. So. West Coast versus North Melbourne on Friday Night Football. It was just a sensational football match. 86 of the 117 minutes, North were in front, but in the end, it was the Eagles in front when it mattered. And if you haven't seen Nick Nat jump amongst the big, big pack and kick the goal, sit tight, you'll see it in a moment. It was just really, really good football, Lingy.
Yeah, what a game of footy, home. It was absolutely fantastic. Both teams really needed the win. They were sitting on 3 and 4. They needed the win to stay in touch with that top eight. They both fancied themselves as finals teams. And North were really sharp early. Daniel Wells and Brent Harvey were terrific in that first quarter, providing plenty of run. West Coast, they kept coming, but they almost cost themselves. They kicked really poorly for goal, and eventually that's going to cost them a game. And we say bad kicking's bad football. Well, that's why North were in front for most of the game, because they were able to finish their work. Jack Zeeble was terrific, finishing with a goal there. It was just Brad Hill, this man here. He is a terrific small forward. He probably tries to do a little bit too much here, but still has the composure to finish it. He's the one who got them back into the game when North were in front and gave him the opportunity, but it was all about this man, Nick Natanui. Huge jump, huge mark, and then the calmness to be able to go back and slot it, and didn't he love it? Just goes and celebrates with the crowd. He is an absolute superstar, that bloke, and what a moment for him. And the three things that I learnt from the game, Brent Harvey has enjoyed his late start to the season. He was full of running, played a terrific game for the Kangaroos. Matty Prittis is one of the best in and under players in the competition and really underrated for his first possession work. He kickstarts a lot of Eagles' running game. And Nick Nat, he is the difference, not just at the end of the game with that mark and goal, but Nick Natanui in the team for the West Coast Eagles makes them a different team. They're all of a sudden that top four finals team that we all thought they would be. His ability to run and jump, and just a phenomenal athlete, Haim.
Talking about athletes, Majak Dawe. We saw photos during the week of Majak coming out of the water after doing recovery. He is just a supreme specimen. But it was just a great moment on Friday night when Nick Nat lined up against Majak in the middle. Fiji versus Sudan. It's a great game.
And I think what you're going to find with Majak, obviously there's going to be inconsistency because he's still learning the game, but probably what North will do more often than not will throw him into the ruck so he can actually get involved. And you see that he actually follows up and gets involved. He's probably learnt that from Nick Natanui because he's the one who does it so well.
Absolutely, absolutely. Maxi, what about Darren Glass? He's 250th game, a fellow defender like yourself. He's been so consistent, so versatile over a long period of time.
Oh, there's so much admiration for him out there, mate. He's obviously been so good. But I think on the weekend, a couple of weeks ago, I don't know who was watching Friday Night Footy, but he actually dislocated his shoulder, came back on, played with an injection, was running around with his elbow like this, like he had it in a sling. And then on Friday night, he played on Lindsay Thomas, the guy who was leading the Coleman medal to that point, and kept him goalless. So it just shows how good he is and how versatile he is.
Absolutely.
Haim, I'm really interested in a couple of the decisions late in the game. Were they there? Were they not? This is Luke Shuey. It's fair to say I think that one's probably in the back, but the Adam Selwood one, Blackie, is that a free kick?
Well, I suppose it is by the letter of the law. It's a bit controversial, isn't it? Drop on the knees. Yeah.
If they weren't in the last 30 or 40 seconds of the game, you probably wouldn't ever talk about them. But the fact they were and they were so influential, it sort of becomes an issue.
And, Ling, you were saying before that Blackie used to do that to you every second time when he contacted.
Yeah, he used to be terrible at it. No, of course not. It's almost like they trained for it, though. And there's nothing wrong with that. You've still got to tackle somebody between the shoulders and the knees. You can't tackle them high. But, Maxie, North Melbourne now, they've had some heartbreaking losses this year, some real close ones, and their win-loss record now isn't looking that healthy because of these.
And it gives them confidence to know that they were in all those games against what first and second on the ladder, and then obviously the Eagles over there, always hard to beat. But it doesn't change the fact that it's 12 points gone. So obviously that's a thing they've got to turn around.
Possible match review incidents, Lingy. Black and Max, you're currently playing, so it gets left to you just to be the sort of the judge and jury.
Yeah, thanks for that, mate. I appreciate that. Oh, I'm not too sure there's really much in this. Lindsay Thomas there, I don't think there's much in that. I think that's a tackle, and you say the swinging arm. Majak Dawe, bit of a push in the face. Well, you could argue that's a bit of gamesmanship. He probably shouldn't have done it. Free kick. I don't think that one's reportable. This is the interesting one. This is the report that's actually been made, Haim. We don't have footage of it. There's no footage of Scotty Thompson. You can just see Matty Rosa there down on his haunches. Something's gone on, but absolutely no footage. A report has been made. But it'll be interesting to see what happens, given that there is no video evidence of that one.
It's like when the fruit's outside the farmer's house. It's just the honesty system from here. You put the money in and take the fruit if you deserve it. So it'll be interesting for Scotty Thompson during the week. Simon Black, mic'd up. That's still to come. Brent McCaffer, an amazing comeback story about his knee. Right now, the nick of eight. Round eight, speed wrap.
Keep going here, Myers. He's outside 50. Thumping kick. Gives it everything and kicks a goal from downtown.
A panic in front of him. Defender peels off. Hill got to his move early. Snaps a goal. Oh, how about that?
And Hodge does the shepherding. Mitchell tried to size it all up. Oh, he got it just right.
Sends it long down towards full forward. Matt Nui. Oh, Matt Nui. Wow, isn't that amazing?
Handball back inside to Motlop. Marley Williams couldn't get hold of him. Motlop around the corner for a miracle goal.
Parker hands it up. This is for number three for Hanbury.
Shut down the time and space, boys. React quickly. Push, push, push.
Oh, against you for high contact.
No way. Great contest out there. Great contest. Hey, Whitey, no certainty this one for you. Hey, hook foot. Oi, hey, Whitey. Yeah. Boys, got to balance up. We've got more time, we think.
A mic'd up Simon Black. When was that, Blackie?
Last year, round two or three against Carlton.
Were you pretty happy with those sledges to put...
Terrible, wasn't it? Wouldn't go down as any top-running sledges, though.
Hook foot?
Yeah.
Too nice.
You can't say much these days, can you?
Nah.
Sydney versus Fremantle last night. The Dockers, they led by 6 points at quarter time, Swans by 18 at half time, Swans by just 9 at three quarter time. But with 10 minutes to go, the Swans led by 27. Freo, they kicked the next four. And Blackie, at the end of it all, they're both probably disappointed teams they didn't win.
Absolutely, Hayne. The nature of a draw, both teams would be disappointed this morning waking up. Look, Freo got off to a flyer. Ballantyne kicked an early goal. He's a very dangerous small forward, as we all know, and it's great to see the old mate Jude Bolton going forward these days and been very dangerous up forward. Kicked a lot of goals so far this year. Another favourite of mine coming up is Dan Hanbury. He's become an elite player this year. He kicked four goals last night, really set Sydney alight, and he's become a really elite player. Look, and this little fella too, Hanbury and Jack. He's a little champ, Jack. He just works so hard. Not many players can run with him. It's a pretty impressive career he started to forge the last 12 or 18 months. And look, yeah, as I said, both teams were very disappointed this morning. Freo's kicking was pretty woeful. 9 goals, 16. They'd be very disappointed with that. And also, as you said, Hayne, that the Swans are actually up by 27 points with 10 or 11 minutes to go. And this incident here, you would have thought Johnson would be able to make the distance with most of those kicks. Unfortunately for him and Fremantle, he didn't. So we've got a tie in the end. Three things I learned from the night. Both sides, I believe, will go deep into September. Both quality outfits. I think Fremantle, they've really started to mature. They persist and really resilient now. So they just don't go away. And as I mentioned, Dan Hanbury's become a favourite player of mine. I love the way he goes about it. Tough little nut, and he's gone to another level this year.
When you were playing in the mids, Lingy and Blackie, are these the sort of young punks that are hard to control, full of confidence early and making their way?
I think we love a bloke like Dan Hanbury because he plays footy the right way, doesn't he, Blackie? He's damaging on the outside, able to kick goals last night, but he goes and wins his own ball and wins the hard contested footy.
He does, doesn't he? The sort of guy he'd love to play with, tough little fella and give you everything he's got every time he goes out to play.
And the respect through the roof from his marking that grand final last year where he stood under the footy and incredible courage to do that.
You speak about draws and being disappointed. It's an obvious statement, but the Swans had Freo cold and then Freo had the shot with 15, 20 seconds to go. So, horrible feelings. You've played in probably the most famous draw, Maxie, in recent memory. When the siren goes, I know you were very vocal afterwards about playing extra time in the granny. What's the sort of the mood?
Oh, as Blackie said, you're gutted because both teams had the opportunity to win the game. So obviously Sydney, I think they were 27 points up with 11 minutes to play. They were still 19 points up with about 6 minutes to play, so they'd be pretty disappointed. They're a hard team to score against at the best of times, so they'll be disappointed. But then Fremantle, I mean, they had those last couple of shots where they could have just scored or someone could have punched it through. So this is, I think, Maynard's, he's arguably the best set shot in the competition. So I was going to ask Blackie, I mean, how did the Fremantle players react to that? Were they actually getting down on themselves when they see guys missing goals? Or
I think that's what happened. The pressure builds, doesn't it? When your teammates start missing, and it comes your turn, there's a fair bit of pressure and responsibility in your hands. So there's no doubt the Fremantle players would have felt that at times last night.
And Fremantle, with their forward line, they almost can't take a trick at the moment. Another forward got hurt last night, Michael Walters. He appears to have hurt his ankle quite badly. I think it just gets trapped underneath there as he gets tackled and looks quite nasty. But you add that on the top of Matty Pavlich and also Kepler Bradley, it starts making it really hard for Fremantle to find those forward options.
I haven't played at the SCG, so I didn't realise you had to go through the crowd to get to the rooms afterwards.
He's got about a 9K walk the way it is with the redevelopment at the moment, so his ankle's completely buggered.
That's
now
just to really rub it in, isn't it? He's got to walk through the bar and out to the change room out the back.
Time for a break. On the other side, Maxi reviews the Big Pies win. And Brent McCrapp, he was a part of last night. He joined us. He's in the game day forum. A premiership pie back from the knee, Rico.
Kicks into the pocket. McCaffer. First kick in league football. 21-year-old Brent McCaffer has nailed it.
White might get a second crack. McCaffer kicks the goal. Then kicked the first three.
Number 30, Brent McCaffer. Went to McCaffer.
Tap a bit sore, McCaffer.
Getting it as deep as he can. And what a mark to McCaffer. Back from the knee reconstruction. What a fitting way to finish up a great day for the Collingwood Football Club. Brent McCaffer.
What a great story. Debuted on Anzac Day. Goal with his first kick. Knee reconstruction. Premiership player. Welcome, Brent McCaffer.
Thanks, mate. Thanks for having me.
Debuting on Anzac Day. One of the rare few that have done that. Nice way to start the career.
Yeah, it was obviously a massive game and the build-up towards it, and just so excited to get out there and, you know, to play on Anzac Day was such a privilege.
And goal with the first kick in footy.
Yeah, pretty nervous going back. Just didn't want to kick it out on the fall and, yeah, managed to put it through.
There's been a few that have done it. Tommy Haley talks about himself the whole time. He was off the ground playing for the Power at that point, but it's a big club to be a part of and, more importantly, a premiership player now. It's just been a fabulous time. Is he just as good a captain as everyone says?
Yeah, absolutely. For all the young guys that come through the club, and, you know, Max, he's always there and willing to do anything off-field, on-field, and just think that's what makes him such a great leader.
Well, let's go to the game last night, Max. It was your game. The Pies, they've got a good record in the last season and a half over the Cats. Bucks hasn't got beaten by Chris Scott as yet. At one stage last night, the Pies by 5 goals, and the Cats got up by 13 points at three-quarter time, and the Pies wrestled the momentum back, and it was just the one goal, and that's all you needed.
Yeah, the last few years has been some absolutely classic games. You go back to 2007 prelim, I guess, was where it really started, and it's just built from there, how the two teams, every time they play each other, it's a pretty tough game and tight game. So this guy here, Motlop, he's just unbelievable. He kicked 2 goals in the night, and he's someone who I don't enjoy chasing because he puts 20 metres on me in about the space of a second. So Scotty Pendlebury, you know how good he is. He had another 31 touches last night and finished with a couple of goals himself. So he's just all class. Just so good to see this guy back, Andy Cracker. It's his third game back, so he's only going to get better. But coming back from that knee reconstruction, we know that he's only going to get better as he gets more game time under his belt. Jamie Elliott, very good young player who you see him kicking goals, but he's also someone who puts a lot of pressure on for us in that forward line, which is exactly what we need. And Andrew Mackey, that was a point where Geelong really looked like they had the game. Third quarter, they kicked 8 goals and really started to take momentum away from our footy club. But look, really proud of the guys in the last quarter here where they fought back, and you see Jamie Elliott here puts makes scores level. And look, the three things that I learnt from the game with number one, Harry O, he's back to his best. He spent a fair bit of time on the wing. Given we've lost Tuvi, Heath Shaw and Dale Thomas on the weekend, then we had to send him back and played really well as a defender. Stokes is a genuine quality midfielder now. He's gone forward. He's had 31 touches again last night, and he's someone who just you can just say he's quality midfielder now. He's reached that point. Number three, Sammy Dwyer. I think he could be the recruit of the year. He's a player who's come in, played a lot of VFL footy, finally got his chance, and I guess I want to ask Lingy, there must be a lot of guys out there who are in a similar position who, if they had the opportunity to actually play football day in, day out and practice what they do day in, day out, surely there'd be other guys who could step in and play similar roles.
Oh, absolutely, Maxie. And I think it's guys like Sam Dwyer, Michael Barlow, James Podziadli, these types of guys. They've got to give a lot of belief to a lot of players out there who don't necessarily get drafted at 18 years of age and go through the traditional system. There's so many more avenues now, so many great development programs that give these players an opportunity.
Dane Zorko, another. Harry O, tell us about his game last night, Brent.
Yeah, I thought he was fantastic. He was really noticeable out there, and a few times I was had the job on Saud and he was able to push over and cover for me and push back in defence. And obviously he gives great run off halfback as well. And you see there his use of the ball, it was fantastic.
And Brent, you mentioned your role on Joel Saud and Harry O'Brien's ability to help you out a few times. Tell us about your move from being a forward to now playing a tagging role. You've had a few big job so far this year. Was it your idea? Did you go to the coaches or did Bucks approach you? How did it all come about and are you enjoying it?
Yeah, I am enjoying it. I love sort of having a role in the team and knowing that, you know, if I can do my job, it's going to go a long way to helping the side win. And, you know, Bucks came to me and said, you know, I'm looking to, you know, something new for you to sort of reinvigorate you, and wanted to throw me down back, obviously. We've had a few guys go down with injury and stuff like that, so it started by going down there and just gave me the role with Del Santo, went all right and sort of gone from there.
Blackie, when you played, who was the hardest player to beat?
I've always said my old mate here, Lingy, and Brett Kirk. Yeah, those two were. But Lingy is big-bodied on baller, so he was hard to move, hard to get around. And Brett Kirk was just so persistent, so disciplined and just a real warrior. So those two were probably my toughest.
We saw Brent Staker yesterday, Lingy, come back, knee reconstruction, Brent McCaffer and Andrew Cracker as well.
Oh, it was great to see Andrew Cracker back. BT calls him the MCG specialist and he didn't let us down again last night. He just adds that little bit extra to the team, doesn't he, Brent? Where he's damaging with the footy, he's so clever around the footy, but he puts on so much pressure as well.
Yeah, absolutely. We're all wrapped to get him back in the side and wanted him back there as soon as we can. I think he kicked 3 goals last night. He's just so creative and as you said, damaging with the ball.
And he's clever there. He just sneaks off the mark there. I think a few Geelong supporters in the crowd thought he should have gone back behind. But if you see it here, he's actually right on the mark. Mackie and Harry Taylor aren't really concentrating and he sneaks in and makes it a bit easier for himself.
I thought Mackie was going to put him in the crowd then. He was following for about 20 metres afterwards.
I think Mack might have been a bit dirty. He snuck away. But that's just another example of how clever he is, just taking any opportunity to make sure he kicks a goal.
So if you're on the mark, right on the mark, it's OK to play on. If the defender's caught behind the mark, it doesn't have to come around. The defender has the obligation to go onto the mark, doesn't he?
That's correct. That's the way I'd say. I don't have a problem with what happened there. It's just clever by Andy Cracker.
Darren Jolly on Matty Stokes, a case of big and tall and looks OK.
These are one of the hard ones. If you see the precedent from last week, Darren Jolly might be in a little bit of trouble, but it's one of those ones where the ball's in the area, the player there, Matty Stokes, needs to have a bit of awareness about what's going on around him. The unfortunate thing is, any contact to the head is certainly looked at, and we've seen that from James Kelly's one last week on Brendan Goddard, so it'll be interesting to see the way the match review panel and the tribunal handle that one.
Brent, this is the injury report at the Pies at the moment. We need your honesty because Maxie sort of deflects a fair bit of things, particularly on the bottom one. We've got a couple of weeks in for Dale Thomas. I think that's coming off the website. Is that right, inaccurate?
Well, I think, yeah, we're going to see how he goes over the next week or two. So hopefully it is only 2 weeks because we can't really afford to have any more injuries and guys not playing. So
trained
hopefully
him well, Maxie, haven't you? Said nothing there.
Knows exactly what to do.
Just a beautiful straight bat there. But an interesting thing from last night I noticed, Haim, was Steve Johnson in the coach's box for the Cats. And Chris Scott's actually got up out of his seat here, gone back and talking to Stevie about what's going on in the field. Stevie's giving his opinion here. Maxie, you've spent a bit of time in the coach's box and with Mick Malthouse when he was coaching. Would you have ever spoken up like that?
With Mick, I did not say one word. I was too sad. And even with Bucks over the last 4 weeks, he just sort of said, mate, there's about 8 guys in here, so no need to be throwing out comments. But at quarter time, half time, three quarter time, if you're seeing something that hasn't been spoken about, please grab me and make sure that I know about it.
coaching sends very normal men insane. Is it true that James Kelly was sitting injured in a box once and got a 30-second spray from Bomber and he wasn't even playing?
No, it was his fault with what was going on out in the field. And he was, poor bloke was just sitting there copying it. I mean, it was Cal, so it's okay for Bomber to do that. I fully support Cal copying a spray, but, yeah, a little bit unlucky when you haven't done anything wrong. Yeah,
I sort of think last night also Stevie Johnson might have said to Chris Scott, come back here, I need to talk to you. In the middle of the game, it wouldn't have been Scotty going to Stevie J. Stevie J's got things sort of under control. Brent's knee operation. Speak about that in just a moment. And what did Harry say to Tom Hawkins? It's all still to come on Game Day.
And ACL, and just immediately I was just sort of overcome with emotion.
He wants to be a coach, but he seems to fumble over his words a fair bit when he speaks, so might take a fair while to get through the meetings.
I just remember, I think it was Tooves had the ball and I've gone to run past to get a handball. The ball sort of just fumbled about on the ground in front of me as I've gone down to pick it up. The Bulldogs players come sliding in and I've just seen him out of the corner of my eye and I've sort of just braced myself for it. But he's quickly just gone in and I just heard the knee crack.
It's up a bit sore, McCaffrey.
Took me off and straight down into the rooms with the doc, and he's grabbed my leg and done the quick ACL test that they do. They just sort of pull it a bit and they can tell straight away, and then he's just looked at me and just shook his head and said, "Nah, you've done your ACL," and just immediately I was just sort of overcome with emotion. It is pretty scary going in towards surgery, I suppose. You know, you're knocked out and you don't know, you know, what's going on, whether it's been successful, there's been a mishap or anything like that. I just remember being in the hospital and you know, just having a conversation with the surgeon and the doctors, and then the next thing I know, just woke up and, you know, it was all done.
Welcome back to Game Day. Round one of the NAB Cup 2012 is when the knee went. You made your way back through the VFL late last year. Just a memory now. Do you feel it after a game, or is it just like the other?
Sometimes after a game, yeah, lying in bed, the knee can get a bit stiff and, you know, I might need to stick a pillow underneath it just to, so it's got a bit of a bend. But I'm completely over it now and don't even, you know, think about that I've had an injury to my knee anymore when I play a game. So it's a really good feeling now to be completely over it.
You speak to the guys that have done an ACL and there's almost a Rico club. You know all the other players that have had it. Did you enjoy watching Brent Staker yesterday? You probably would have been getting ready in the rooms.
Yeah, no, I saw him kick that goal at the end of the game and, you know, you do take an interest in all the guys that have had injuries to the knee now and, you know, wish them all the best when they get back, and it's great to see, you know, I suppose Bawley come back yesterday and play as well. So, yeah, it's great to see.
Before you get on to the Hawks and the Giants, you were a very good friend of John McCarthy's and now wear his number in memory. How did that come about? Was Bucks that came to you?
I was going to contact Bucks and sort of ask if that's something I could do, but before I did that, he called me and actually, you know, said, you know, is that something you'd be interested in? And, you know, which is great by him to sort of show that sort of support and to wear his number, you know, really humbled and really privileged to be able to do that.
Yeah, well done. It's a nice story. The Hawks, they're on top of the ladder now. The Giants still winless. Buddy just kicked a couple. Mitchell was prolific. And Ruffy, he's like Ed Norton. Give him any sort of a role and he just nails it. He kicked five, did a bit of ruck work, was defensive as well. Mitchell, 35. Maxey, 83-point win to the Hawks. Could have been more, according to the press, during the week, but it was plenty.
Yeah, I think they were $1.001 or something like that, Hawthorn, going into the game. So, look, everyone knew what the result was going to be. But, look, GWS and Sheeds would have been very happy. They really fought it out, probably in the first 2.5 quarters. Hawthorn's experience started to get to him in the last quarter and a half. But early on, it was only sort of 4 or 5 goals, the margin up to half-time. And then this guy here, Taylor Adams, he's going to be a star, and I'll talk about him in a minute. And Sean Burgoyne, just watch these quick hands here that he has in tight. He had 18 clearances against us one day when he was playing for Port Adelaide. So you forget how good he is in the midfield and how classy he is because he spent so much time down back the last couple of years. And Jeremy Cameron kicked 4. It's a real shame that Patton's gone down because so much focus is going to go on to Cameron defensively. But look, he's standing up and he's going to be a very good player. Brad Sewell doesn't kick many goals of pretzel, but got one there. And look, as you can see, they kicked away right at the end. But three things I learned. Number one, Taylor Adams, I said, he will be elite. He's outstanding. He had 9 tackles as well. So he does the defensive stuff as well as the offensive stuff. Number two, the Hawks bat deep. Still had a few injuries, but guys came in and played their role. Good to see Simkin playing well, another mature age guy coming from Geelong. And number three, Ruffy. Well, he's Mr. Versatile. He's unbelievable. He played deep forward yesterday. Just have a look at this, running out of the screen there, sprinting back the goal square, turns around, straight back up from Buddy. gets it, kicks the goal. Next one here, he's up on the wing, using the ball beautifully, and finally, out of defence. So he can do it all. He goes up, looks after the Hawks when there's a few goals against him or they really want to shut down the play, goes behind the play and can obviously take a big mark as well. So he's been outstanding.
And Nick, we all know how good Sam Mitchell is. He had another prolific day yesterday.
Tell me a little bit about that. Yeah, he had 35 touches. And with Mitchell, you just know how good he is with his hands more than anything. And look, have a look at this. Just puts the ball where he wants the guy to lead. So Ruffy wasn't even moving. Then he just chips it out in front of him. And this one's not too bad. He'll want to replay this one a few times. Left foot banana from the boundary line. So, yeah, he's all quality. And he's spent a fair bit of time at half back this year, just really trying to set them up from half back. But been playing on the ball yesterday.
He's one of the best non-preferred side kicks you'll ever see, isn't he?
I don't even think he has a preferred anymore.
Yeah. No, he almost classes himself as a left footer. Another one of the left footers, and speaking about their run off half back, Grant Birchall. Teams are now almost identifying him as a key to Hawthorn and are sending run with roles to Grant Birchall. Who did the job yesterday?
Yeah, Palmer. You can see they're getting pretty physical here, and Palmer actually kicked a goal and did a really good job on him. And Hawthorn tried to get him involved in the game, but one thing I noticed with GWS was they were really physical with him, so it wasn't just Palmer. They all really went after him and tried to get stuck in him and get into his head.
Indigenous round nine, Brent, so get used to that. That's what you're going to be seeing a lot of next weekend. Blackie, you're playing under light, so it's a yellow ball for you. Marcus Lee is the artist that has designed the ball. If you are a ball collector or want one of the balls that will be played with in round nine, go to Rebel Sport or Target. And Sharon will donate 10% of sales to support the employment of Indigenous trainees via AFL Sports Ready. So, well done to the team at Sharon. Welcome to you, Mark Stevens.
Hey, mate, great to be here. Great looking footies, aren't they?
They're good looking footies. I reckon I might find one of those in my car in about 40 minutes. And I know the producer wants one as well. Harry O, Tommy Hawkins, anything, nothing? There was tweets and chats. And
yeah, I mean, Dave Warner made the news yesterday on Twitter, and Harry O, about midnight, had to clarify something. He was accused of a homophobic slur on Tom Hawkins. Let's have a look at it now and make up our own mind. I'm not a lip reader, but you can see quite clearly here that Hawk has a go, and then Harry hits back.
Storming a teacup, this one, mate. Harry O, of all people, is not someone who's going to discriminate against anyone at all. So, as you can see, he's fixed up those comments right there and explained the situation.
Shows the power of Twitter, though, Hammer, doesn't it, that Harry feels obliged half an hour or so after the game to clear that up. There were several people on Twitter there that were replaying it and going through what he said.
And Gary Lyon, Mark Neild yesterday on Triple M, had a bit to say.
Yeah, he did. I'm not sure whether Mark Neild will be replaying this, Hammer, because it really, the heat is coming on in the kitchen now. Of course, a big game today for Melbourne against Richmond. Let's have a look at what Gary had to say.
Well, the appointment. I mean, if you when you come back to it, you say, did you get the appointment right? Well, right now, there's nowhere near the level of development of that group of players that you would want.
Do you think Mark Neild will be there in 2014? And would you appoint him to be there? Would you allow that contract to play out if you were back in charge?
No, I think it would absolutely need to be reviewed.
That's interesting because Gary basically appointed Mark Neild and now clearly he's wavering on that, and it probably doesn't help Mark Neild's cause going into the big game today. And of course he's contracted till the end of next year, but it seems now it'll be reviewed before that, Hammer.
And your doggies finding it tough to win?
Yeah, well basically it was a tough day at the office today. I think they really should have expected to beat Gold Coast. You go up there with a lot of senior players still on the side, Cooney, Griffin, etc. Dominated the play early, then to go down by 32 points, pretty disappointing display. This is what Brendan McCartney had to say.
You're away for a period in time. You just got to hang in there, and that clearly is the biggest challenge and obstacle in front of our team. And they accept that. We accept that. We know where we're at, and we're working really strongly every day to get better at it. And the only way for younger players in particular to really master it is to keep living through it and not let it happen the next time.
I admire the perseverance there, but the facts are they've won one of their last 19 games, Hammer. The natives are getting a little bit restless out at the Bulldogs. We're talking about a side that played in three prelims in a row not that long ago. So I think we have to stick fat out there at the kennel and back Macca in. But it'd be interesting just to see where the board sits because, Mark Neild under pressure. The record now is fairly similar there, although the Dogs have had a far tougher run in the past year or so.
Steve, I just reckon that now there's so much media around our game that what do the media want? Do they want everyone to win the same amount of games and all be even?
Because not at all.
There's Bulldogs, Melbourne, we talk about Vossi during the week and then obviously one game win and it turns around. What do we want? We've got to understand that it can't be judged on win-loss for a lot of these teams. It has to be judged on the individuals developing, and that's what it comes down to. And I think that at times the media are just too harsh on trying to pot coaches.
clearly there's been development there and they're on the right track, but one out of 19, I know, speaks for itself. And I think we'll see a few more wins by the end of the year, but I think next year is when Brendan McCartney really gets judged.
Plenty of chatter about the illicit drugs that came out during the week. There were more tests positive than last year, but from when you have a look at society, I was amazed at how few tested positive. I might be in a minority, and I've got to choose my words carefully, but it's a very low percentage given the proliferation of drugs about the place.
I suppose the bare figures are a little bit alarming, though, 6 to 26, and Andrew Demetriou admitted it was disappointing, not devastating. I suppose the issue is there that we've now got three players on two strikes, and I'm surprised that Dr. Peter Harcourt, the AFL medico, was so open about the drug use. And did he really have to say, Maxi, that cocaine was the drug of choice? It's perhaps too much detail for the playing group.
Yeah, I guess I've been a bit naive to all this because I'm a married man now, mate, with two kids, so I don't get a chance to go out and see what happens out there. But I think in the end, the important thing that Andrew Demetriou spoke about was it's actually saving lives. There's been indications of certain players. I think it's one in five players have sought help from the AFL Players Association on depression or anxiety and these type of things. So obviously at times players turn to different things to try and help their situation, but players have been stood down from actual games of football because of different problems that they've had. So I think everyone's just got to understand that it's about helping the individual and we're not trying to go out there and it's not a witch hunt.
But the players put their hand up for this, obviously. It was a new thing that came in 5-6 years ago. Credit to them. Brent, is it hard, though, for the image when you see 6 to 26 headlines and almost a slur on the playing group when you put up your own hand to be tested?
Yeah, it is, obviously. You know, you don't want drugs in footy. But, you know, we do if we have drug testers coming in, you know, once, twice a week at the footy club. So, you know, obviously not great to see that it's gone up from last year, but you just got to try and stand
26 of 2,000 tests, and there's 20 that have self-reported themselves. I'm amazed at how small the number is, to be honest. And the testing is better this year at the right times and more regularly. It's going to go up.
Yeah, the interesting thing is Dr. Harcourt admitted there hasn't been a positive test at all this year. Now, the trouble area is, of course, in the off-season. And there's part of talk now around Hammer that players maybe should get a longer break. There's so much pressure. They then get a small area to sort of let their hair down. And this is where the issues come about.
Plenty of news. Demons this afternoon. Steve-O, thank you.
We're heading to the G. Hopefully, Neildy goes OK.
Richmond versus the Demons on Sunday afternoon football after the break. What you didn't know about Simon Bray.
He's always running late, so he's the last bloke to train. And
he loves to sleep in, so turning up late to a training or meeting is a common occurrence.
Yeah, he wants to be a coach, but he seems to fumble over his words a fair bit when he speaks.
Probably sleeping again, so...
Most of them have probably moved on. He's been around for so long that he's probably lost a few of his mates.
It was a funny thing. We left his phone in the gym the other week and we went to his friend finder and couldn't find anything.
That's McGrath, Joel Pappel talking about Simon Black. I read during the week, Pies TV, 24 hours, not enough Collingwood at the moment. Caff, I understand you are getting into the media, enjoying it, and probably going to be the host.
I don't know about being the host, but yeah, I've got an interest in the media, but no, I don't know if I'll be hosting something like that.
Here's a possible lineup of what could happen on Pies TV. We've got Deal or No Deal, hosted by Dale at 5:30. Magpie Inc., hosted by Dane and Dane. Home and Away, starring Marty Clark. Parking Wars, Gary Pert and Travis Cloak go head-to-head. Keeping Up with the Cloaks, Travis Cameron, Jason and David. The Tab Update, Heath Shaw will take care of that little hourly show. And Get Smart, starring Nick Maxwell Smart.
Pretty good, mate. Well done. Yeah.
It's the best of the producers in the back room. Sounds good, sounds bad. Matthew Leuenberger and Daniel Rich are out of contract, Lingy.
Sounds bad for Brisbane because they're hot property. Two quality players. Brisbane would want to sign them up straight away. If they can get their signatures, it'll be good for Brisbane.
Maxi's about to sign a new deal. Sounds good, Brent?
Absolutely, yep.
OK. Wait was fined for stupidity, Blackie. Sounds tough for a lot of footballers.
It is. It's the reality, though, isn't it? You can't let the club down these days. They'll jump all over you pretty quickly. So it was probably unfortunate, but it is what it is.
Simon Black to coach.
I love the game. I love trying to help improve teams' performances. So at some stage, post-playing days, I'd like to possibly be a coach of some sort.
Would you have him at your club, Lingy?
Sounds good, Hayne. He will be a remarkable coach.
OK. Time for quick hands. Nick Maxwell, Brett McCaffrey. Maxie, you're in charge.
Now, I know, Caff, I know the truth, so let's be honest here. I just want yes, no answers. That's it, all right? Is it true you've asked some of the boys to start calling you Libba after your recent role tagging?
Absolutely not.
Is that true, Maxie?
That is true. Is it true you record Home and Away and the Kardashians so you don't miss a minute?
Yes.
Do you really put Vegemite on your toast and then margarine afterwards?
Yes.
Weird. Is it true that you have more mouth-to-mouth action with your dog Benji than your girlfriend? Oh, Jesus.
Possibly.
You and your housemate take your PlayStation games very seriously. Is it true that after big games, you actually record press conferences?
Yes.
Do you have a man crush on the man sitting to the right of me?
Yes.
Finally, and most importantly, is it true you're currently planning your proposal to the gorgeous Tamsin?
Absolutely not.
No. Oh, very
well,
good.
You should be then. You should be.
Well very done, mate. Good, quick. That was completely uncomfortable for you.
Stop, man.
It was. Now, Lingy, we've had Felicia in the crowd for the best part of an hour screaming at us about not getting enough. That 13 ladies on a power women's trip.
All I've heard about is, when are we talking about Port Adelaide? When are we talking about Port Adelaide? Well, here we go, OK? Big, big game for Port Adelaide today against Carlton. I love how much the Port Adelaide have improved over the season. Kenny Hinckley's done a wonderful job there. He's got them playing with real belief. A lot of those younger guys have improved. But coming up against Carlton, it'll be a really tough one. Carlton, they'll be a bit angry about losing to St Kilda on Monday night, so they'll want to make amends. Sorry, Felicia, but I'm going to tip Carlton in that one there. Hey? Probably not the smartest thing I've ever done.
And we've got Richmond and Melbourne this afternoon at the MCG as well. Tigers short price favourites. Caff, we had about 407 tweets since you said you weren't planning to propose to Tamsin. How long have you been seeing each other?
It's creeping up towards 2.5 years.
And you are how old?
Oh, I'm 25.
And how old's Tamsin?
She's still only 20, so she needs a couple
more
years.
Plenty of time. Yeah. Okay. Hey, Brent, great to have you on. Congratulations with the recovery of the knee.
Thanks, mate.
Maxie, well done. Indigenous round next weekend. You've got who?
Andy Cracker.
And in regard to you, who are you playing?
We're playing Sydney.
And you've got the Blues on Saturday night, Blackie?
At home.
Great to have you on board. Well played yesterday. Full game, mate. We expect next weekend?
Yeah, I hope so. Hope so.
Now, Lingy, Cats are going to bounce. Tell me they're going to bounce.
They'll bounce back home. And I'm off to the MCG this afternoon, the Richmond-Melbourne game. Looking forward to that one. Another, hopefully, good game of footy to watch.
And we've got you back next weekend. Brian Taylor's making a rare appearance with G, yourself and Bob Murphy.
Yeah, looking forward to that one. It'll be great to have BT on here. And always love Bobby Murphy. Yeah, what a creative mind he's got.
Creative Bob Murphy and a very angry Brian Taylor. See you next Sunday at 10 a.m. Thanks for your company today.